Yo!
What's up? This is Patrick.
And this is Buck Woody.
And in this video, Buck and I are talking all about data. Stay tuned. If you find this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date from all the videos from both Adam and this guy. Woo! Buck. It's been a long time, but this is not your first time in the cube.
I was in the cube and I was actually like in a show and Adam put me in the cube.
Adam put you in the cube. but you know what people don't realize? You can't put Buck in a box or even
Nobody
or a cube.
Nobody puts baby in the corner. Nobody puts baby in the corner.
But since you were here last time, some things have changed with you. Why don't you tell us what you're doing these days?
Yeah, so I'm a principal data scientist. Nice fancy title. In the Azure data and AI area. So I actually work over in engineering these days, teach a lot of classes, do a lot of videos. And I also work a lot with large and small clients.
Oh, that's interesting. So we said we're going to talk about data. That's what I said at the beginning. So what trends are you seeing? What are your customers doing with data today?
The interesting thing is I'm hearing almost the same story from small customers, medium customers, and large customers.
Wow.
And the problem is this, you probably see it all the time as well when you're at conferences or talking to people. What data do we even have? Yeah. Nobody knows where it's at. Yeah. And then can I trust it? Like I get an inventory number. Do I know where that came from? Oh, do I know where it went?
Yeah.
Can I get to it? You find out it's in some spreadsheet under somebody's desk and they're gone for the week. Can I turn that into like action? Can I get some business insights off of that data? Mm-hmm. Because a lot of times I don't have all the pieces to put together to do something with it. And then finally, what's my compliance story? Mm-hmm. Did you know there are hundreds of regulations around the world? So if you're a multinational company, and by the way, you don't have to be that big to be a multinational company. It's still got to be governed. You still got to take care of all the legal stuff, Patrick.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, a lot of people ask for, is there a tool? Can I just buy a tool?
Yeah.
Can I buy a platform
yeah.
and just fix all this? And there is a couple ways you can go about that. There are platforms that claim to be sort of end to end. You could do that.
Yeah.
But the day to day, the actual work that we do every day is in databases. It's in Power BI. It's in data warehouses already.
Yeah.
And so what we really need is not another tool. We really need a data culture.
Oh, man. In the organization that I work in, Power BI organization on the engineering side, and data culture is just like, it's not a word we throw around. It's a word that we live by. Because when you create a Power BI data set, when you create a Power BI report, we are taking that data and that report, and guess where we're putting it? Not in the hands of the developers, not in the hands of the, you know, these coders. We're putting it in the hands of the people that own that data, that use that data, that can make better decisions with that data. Yeah.
They say that companies who embrace a data culture, there is a 4x increase in revenue performance and customer satisfaction. That's a study from Harvard Business.
Wait a minute, Buck. So you're telling me I'm not some fancy data scientist. I'm not some fancy program manager or database administrator. I'm an analyst or, you know, I'm an information worker. And if you give me my data, the data I probably entered, if you give it back to me in a well-formed way, we're going to make more money?
Absolutely. Think about this for just a quick minute. In your job today, right now, if you knew the thing you were working on was wasting your time, if you had some way to find the data that says customers don't care about this, don't do a video on it, would that make you more money? Of course it would.
Yes.
Because you'd be spending your time on something customers do care about, and you'd actually be taking care of business.
I get it. We need to put data in the hands of the people that really can use it, okay? How do we do it? Microsoft's got to have something that I can go buy.
Of course. I mean, that's what we do, right? So Patrick, let me introduce to you the Microsoft Intelligent Data Platform. Well, it's actually three big pieces. We tried to simplify this as much as possible. The first is data governance, where you do all of this tagging of your data, you make it open to everybody, and then we layered in all the databases you currently know and love and other databases you don't know you need yet. And then at the end, we put some analytics over the top of that. You'll be happy to know that there's this little product called Power BI that can use this entire process to literally get that to Patrick. Hey, what are people asking about the most on social media right now? about data visualizations.
Yeah.
And you find out, oh, it's choosing the right graphic type. You produce the right video. You get millions of hits. You make tons of money. You retire in the Bahamas. You're a happy man. Yeah. But you work on the wrong thing, something no one cares about. Yeah. Like showing numbers literally raw with a bad font.
Yeah.
You make a video on that because you think it's important.
No way.
You die penniless and alone.
So we got this stack of technology.
We do.
And we can put those together to make better decisions, provide better data. But where do I start?
We start with the governance. You got to know where it is to figure out what you do. Have you heard of this thing called Purview? Microsoft Purview.
A little bit. Heard of it a little bit.
All right. So a lot of folks may not realize that Purview is not a single thing. It's actually a group of things, and it's got different functionality in it. The first part is there's this thing called Purview Data Map.
Yeah.
So you can create a map of where your data is, where it came from, and where it goes to. And this forms something called lineage. And it literally gives you this pipeline look of the data started out in our point of sale system. It was entered into a SQL Server database that was pumped over into Cosmos to do some graph APIs. And then it came back out and I touched a few fields to do some machine learning in R inside, let's say, Synapse or something that. The next thing it can do can provide your users a glossary. Have you ever heard of data catalog?
I've heard of data catalog.
Yeah. And how many of those have you seen put in? go ahead. You can say it. It's a very small number. Yeah. It's a very small number. And it's that way because it has lots of problems. First thing is it's very brittle.
Yeah.
Like I've got to go enter all that data. It's very closed. You have to have a login to that tool. You have to know how that tool works. I ain't got no time for that, right?
Yeah.
The other thing is when the data changes, it's dead. So what you're allowed to do is allow your users to actually tag the data and then even say, who put this in here? So I trust Patrick because he works in our finance system.
Yeah.
So if it's a financial number, I'll trust Patrick over some schmo that's put a data entry in there.
So would I be like a data steward for this financial data because I'm the subject matter expert?
Right. There's a steward that runs the catalog. There are people who are the subject matter experts. There are the users. All kinds of permissions here. Now, Patrick, this is not the data. This is a description of the data pointing to where it lives.
So it's the metadata.
That's correct.
Okay.
And not only that, it'll give you a connection string, not a password and name, of course, but it'll tell you, oh, that SQL Server, here's a connection string to get to it. If I'm a Power BI person, do I need much else?
I need access.
Right.
Yeah.
And it shows you who the owner of that data is. So you say, hey, can I have access to that?
No, that's
nice. And then you put the string in. And you're done.
I'm old school. Fuck, I'm old school. I've been doing this for decades, not just one decade, decades. And this reminds me of something we used to build that never came to fruition. We never finished it. But it reminds me of this thing called a data dictionary.
It's the data dictionary. It's the data glossary. It's all that.
Nice.
We fixed it in a couple of ways. One thing is that mapping tool. If you're Oracle or Postgres or SQL Server, we'll run down over your data and we'll figure out columns and rows and we'll pre-populate it for you. So you get that schema discovery. You have to have permission. And by the way, the data steward can say, hey, this is PII or this is governed by some rule. And then if Patrick's not allowed to see it, just doesn't show up for Patrick.
Wow.
But we're not done. You got to put all this stuff someplace, right?
Somewhere.
And normally with these data catalogs, they're tied to like a database. We decide not to do that.
Yeah.
You can annotate any data anywhere, a CSV file, like an Excel spreadsheet under Diane's desk, whatever. If it's data, we'll collect it. After we've done that, you say, well, great. It looks like we've got a spreadsheet under Diane's desk, which really should be our relational system.
Yeah.
What do you got?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, we've got a few databases for you. We've got Azure SQL. We've got Azure Cosmos DB. We've got Postgres. We got MySQL. We got your MariaDB. We've even got Cassandra.
Wow.
Well, wait. There's more.
Okay.
The word of the day is cache. You got to have a Redis cache. And you know what? We support Redis cache. You're probably using some of these already. That's where that wiring is coming up. So I can find it. And when I find it, I say, oh my gosh, we have three places where we're storing inventory. Let's rewrite that function, make it an API, and do that in Cosmos. We'll leave the transactions in SQL Server on-prem. We'll do some of our customer transactions out in Azure SQL. But I want to click a button and find inventory. Yeah. We could do that.
So, so we just went on this journey. How do I stitch all this together though?
We have various analytic tools that we can use for these things. They're all kind of folded under something called Azure Synapse Analytics.
Yeah.
So we take this data from all over and we dump that into the Azure Data Lake storage.
Yep.
So it's storage that's augmented. So it's got a little processing power around it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then on top of that, we lay Synapse, and it's got three big pieces it can do. Our good old everyday Azure SQL data warehouse, massive amounts of data, structured SQL queries. By the way, we're linking up something called Synapse Link to where you can query your on-prem data and it will reach out and tickle the data warehouse and come back with that query, or the other way around. And it's near real-time analytics.
Nice.
So that's the SQL part. But the cool new kid in town, we do love our Spark.
Yes, you do.
We do love our Apache Spark. So we went ahead and threw an engine inside Synapse that has full Spark availability. So you can do whatever you want off of the same data.
Yeah.
So while I'm doing the data warehouse, I can do the Spark stuff. But wait, there's more. We're still putting the monitoring over that. You now get the security. You're integrated with authorization. You're integrated with RBAC. And by the way, one of the things I didn't mention in Purview, if you're the owner of the data, you can say Buck, Bob, and Jane can have access to this data. It will reach down into SQL Server and make sure that's true. Even in SQL Server, I can't see what I'm not supposed to see.
Wow.
Now, we also have a full studio on top of this. Yes. This is a web-based studio. It's beautiful.
Yep.
But we also have the Azure Data Explorer.
Yeah.
So you've got on-prem tools in a Mac, on Linux, on PCs, in the web, and so on to query and use all this data. I usually take that, whatever I've done my data engineering, to create and train and produce and model and version the model and send the model out for machine learning and AI.
Wow.
But there are those folks out there, don't know if you know any, who are really good with data visualization.
Yeah.
And they can make these real fancy visualizations. You know what I'm talking about? It's a powerful sort of business intelligence tool.
What?
A PBI, a Power BI.
Could that be Power BI?
Yeah.
All right. We have some videos out there where we talked about some of these things, but if you would like Buck and I to dive deep into any of these things, we're talking Synapse Studio, we're talking SQL Server, we're talking AI, right? If you know what to do, post it in the comments below. If it's your first time visiting Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. If you like my video, big thumbs up. As always, from Adam,
Buck,
and myself, thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.